We're here for the commentary of Restless Heart Keep Running. We're going to start with An Open Door, which is the first track of the record. Whether or not you can consider it a track, it's just the opener. It kind of goes hand in hand with Abstracted, but I think everybody in the group decided we should cut them. We should make them two separate songs, even though I was an advocate. I wanted it to all be one because every time we play Abstracted, I wanted the intro. It didn't happen, though. I don't always get my way. But the thing about An Open Door, I think, that's fascinating is that when we went into the studio with Wade, it was like our first real opportunity to really test the waters of using real instruments across the board. And that intro, at least that Joe was working on in the past, was always piano. And I think it was something we thought about, like, hey, this would be a really cool way to open up the record.
You know, Wade, taking a look at it, he told me to scale it back, and he said, we're going to use real piano on this if possible. We're going to record it. So,
hey, guess what, Joe? You're going to have to learn how to play it.
Yeah, so I scaled it back quite a bit and made it a much more playable, I think, honestly, a more musical intro. And I'm really happy with the way it came out.
Abstracted is the second song on the record. And like Joe and Boss had said before, it's a companion piece to An Open Door and The Love That Remains. And I think it's pretty important that it's, you know, the first lyrics to come up in the album to be kind of uplifting. And I think today, in present day, like it's hard to be in the moment. It's hard to with everything going on. It's really tough to stay present. So the words "just be here" could actually mean one of two things. Either, you know, just be here with us when you're listening to the record, or just being present in your own life. And I think that this song prefaces a lot of different themes throughout the record. And for instance, in the second verse, the love that remains comes up in the lyrics, and it's also the name of the last song. So I thought, you know, we like to do that kind of stuff a lot, and I think it's pretty cool. So.
Yeah, it's a jammer. Love the song, one of my favorites. Love the tempo. All the note values are pretty accessible in every direction. We do some really cool stuff. I love the pre-chorus is like really fun ghost note stuff in there. And yeah, what we do actually, which is kind of fun, we do it quite a bit, is in the breakdown, in the bridge, we take the same rhythmic phrase and then we just displace it by an eighth note. And it kind of gives like a new texture to a part that you've just heard. So it's pretty fun.
Yeah.
Fix is the third track on Restless Heart Keep Running. It comes in right away with a really aggressive, punchy, the metalcore, chuggy type intro. And then it kind of flows pretty nicely into one of the catchier, kind of more accessible choruses
on
the record.
Fun chorus, yeah.
Yeah, it's just got that really kind of soaring melody, and it's just that really
bouncy,
head-bobbing tempo. yeah, it was a song that everybody really liked from the get-go. We felt it had a lot of energy, and it really showcased a lot of the more aggressive, heavier side of Capstan and what we were going for with that. And so we chose it to be one of the singles coming from the record as well. It was the last single that was released. And it's just a really fun, energetic song to play live. And there are a lot of really fun, just rhythmic parts, breakdowns. I know, for example, Scott, one of his favorite parts is the breakdown in the second verse. Does the stack thing with some ghost notes on the snare, and it's pretty crazy.
Yeah, anytime he gets to use the stack, he's happy.
He loves the stack, yeah.
Lyrically, so I love that song lyrically. It's on like the surface, it sounds like you're talking about drugs, and I guess it's really up to the listener, because it could also be like whatever you use as your escape. At least that's kind of what I figured. It doesn't have to be drugs, but like,
I would like to say that I think the drug side of it is more of just an analogy. The song itself is about escapism and self-medicating through whatever means.
Yeah,
and just
whatever
like,
means that like you're comfortable with.
Yeah, finding a way to escape, I guess. And yeah. Yeah, for some people, it's drugs. We're not going to candy coat it. But
others, it's music. Yeah. And, you know, whatever just makes you happy. Just roll with what makes you feel good.
I hope wherever you are, you're far, far along. We added a third seat, so this one must be important. Track 4 on the record is We'll Always Have Paris. That's kind of the main single of the record.
Yeah, it's the big song.
That's the big one. And I don't know if it's my personal favorite, but I think everyone in the group really had the idea of going into the construction of this record of having more accessibility just across the board. And We'll Always Have Paris was a song that we really vouched for, at least as the first single, because it was something Capstan hadn't done before. 4 choruses, had a little bit more of a pop a sensibility to it.
It's maybe definitely different from a lot of our other tracks in the past. It definitely has a few elements that are new to Capstan.
And the Imogen Heap intro that Wade kind of helped us put together. It turned out a little different. And I think a lot of people that had known Capstan in the past and heard just that song maybe were like, oh, they're going soft on us. Or like something like that. And it's just, I don't know, you know, comparing it to Fix, like we do that style of music, but we're also here to do this. And we're also here to do the acoustic stuff. And we're really happy with the way this track turned out. I remember writing the lyrics, you know, going back to the themes of the record and like what they mean as a whole, and just the idea of the lyrics, you know, I hope wherever you are, you're far, far along, but not too far gone. That could be a relationship that's soured. It could be someone that left you. It could have been a situation where maybe you lost someone because of death or because of circumstances that are out of your hands. And it's just looking back at the good in that situation and just wishing them well and trying to find some type of solace in the moments you had together, even if things don't look as good now. It's just looking back on the positive, and we thought that was a really important message for this record.
Absolutely. I mean, the song itself, too, we did so many different things with it. Like, as far as the chorus goes, we have a 3-part harmony now that we're doing.
Which, it involves counterpoint.
That.
And which is something that, like, for us three,
modulation, modulation at the end of the song, to a minor third above.
We modulated the last chorus.
We've done that before, but doing it with the harmony as well,
yeah,
while we're singing live, like that was something totally new for us.
Yeah, live, it's hard, but it's fun. It's very fun to do.
But very rewarding. Yeah, it's doing the style of harmony, the arrangement over the chorus is also something new that Capstan hadn't done before previously. You know, we'd always have vocal harmonies on tracks, but we, up until this point, had never gone so in depth as to write 3 different parts in counterpoint style with, you know,
it's easy to follow melodies. With the third. It's really weird when one's changing.
Yeah, that's like, you hear a lot of vocal harmonies, and typically it's always you can hear a third above or below, and you can match a melody in parallel by following it, but it's a lot harder to just hear and write a melody that moves the other way from the main melody, or, you know, stays in a spot and doesn't move when the other one is. And those are the types of harmonies that really showcase the chords and can really exaggerate and resolve tensions and stuff like that. And
which made this chorus that much more unique than other choruses.
We're kind of going for the queen
vibe.
Yeah,
I was gonna say that.
Or
yeah,
I mean, the Eagles
makes it pop. Yeah, Eagles too. Yeah, yeah. We love some good vocal harmony. So that was a big thing for this song as well.
Also, for those of you that don't know, the name of the track is actually from the movie Casablanca.
So yeah, it's a reference to
we'll
an
always
old
have Paris.
Old Humphrey Bogart flick. It's honestly really funny. It's almost like a modern idiom, you know, created in the last 100 years that means exactly what the song is about. Because it's just about looking back fondly on a time in your life with a person that, you know, you're not around anymore, or for some reason you can't be with. But it really fit the song.
Track 5 is I'll Bury the Hatchet When They Bury You. And this is kind of where the production of the record kind of took a different route. We had several more songs that we thought were strong contenders for the record. And this one just kind of came out of left field. Wasn't supposed to be on the record. We had no lyrics written for it going into the studio. And after pre-production, it kind of just was like, man, this is a jam. Like, let's roll with it. And yeah, so all that production was done on the spot, which is pretty sick because I didn't know our lyric writing boys could pop it off like that.
Yeah, that one was pretty stressful because I think there were like, it was like 2 or 3 days where we all just sat and just banging our heads up against the wall trying to figure the lyrics out. But it ended up coming up to like pretty nicely at the end.
I think it came together really good. I love how, I mean, even going into it, the intro riff.
Yeah.
Joe switched up a lot. It was really just eighth note-y, straight up. But it kind of got spiced up with some 16s in there.
Yeah.
And some rest.
It was surprising because we didn't have really anything written
for
it.
It was a total skeleton.
Then Wade just decided that we should do one all in the studio. And it came out great. It's a classic screw you song, or classic fuck you song.
So from a personal perspective, this song ended up having a lot more screaming than I'm used to.
That we've been trying to put in capstan.
Yeah. And it was pretty nice to see Wade, the way that we worked. We had to split up a lot where I would just, okay, this song is done with singing. And, you know, when you're screaming that much, you can't just do it all in one day or just do the entire song. So we had to split that up because it's pretty taxing on vocals.
Especially being there early mornings.
Yeah.
Being a guy that does vocalist too, it's really hard to sing early in the morning.
You need time to
warm
up.
Our end of days would always be vocals.
Yep.
And Hatchet, I think, just was interesting for Anthony because while we have never performed it live, we might. It might end up being a single someday. We've had some people say that it's one of their favorite songs on the record, and I think that means a lot to us because of where Scott and Harry said it kind of came out of nowhere.
Yep.
We can thank Wade a lot for that song coming through, but also it felt cool to work with someone in the studio where it was really open-ended. We didn't have, like they said, a ton of things set in stone on that song, and
right.
We got this whole different vibe of capstan through the production with Wade, and it's like, I wouldn't say that's a song we wouldn't have been able to write on our own, but it's cool because it has a more, I don't know, a radio rock vibe to it, and the way the chorus came together, it seems like a lot of people really like that track. So.
Yeah, there's a lot of really heavy parts in that song too that I enjoy a lot.
We like heavy, so.
Yeah.
Track 6 is Indelible. It's a fun one. It's pretty freeform.
One of my favorites.
Yeah, it's a jam. A high or low key banger, right?
Low key banger, but it could be a high key banger.
I don't know.
I guess it's up to the streams up a little bit more.
Yeah, yeah. But it's pretty freeform. No repeating parts, although Joe seems to think that there are. So I guess there are repeating parts. but it's a really fun one, dynamically very interesting, at least to me. Really quite challenging 16th note double bass section with some sweepy boys on it. Yeah, it's a fun one. What do you think about it?
So the lyrics are probably, it's some of my favorite lyrics on the record for sure. Just the entire build-up from the soft, and Anthony actually sings it like a little differently than he's sang before, like on some of the other songs. But it's kind of, to me, it's very much about just a chaotic relationship with someone else, where you might really feel for this person, but you know that it's still not, it's not healthy.
So yeah, this song actually features some other instrumentation, has a saxophone on a pretty prominent part.
Yeah,
played by
solo.
Yeah, it is. Played by our good friend Billy Meether.
And it's kind of cool with the ending, like the word indelible, it's kind of a mark that just never fades. And that's kind of like what the song's about, if you think about it with relationships and the impact that they have on you. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad.
But it's there.
But yeah. It's always there.
Track number 7, There Is No Answer. This is one of my favorite tracks on the record, absolutely. It's very different for us compared to things we've done in the past. It's the first song Capstan's ever done with all electric guitars that doesn't have, you know, distortion
breakout
or like heavy
some
parts.
Sort.
Yeah, it's there's a real vibe, a real mood to it, a real, you know, kind of solemnity, I guess. And it's a song that, surprisingly, actually, I had on a shelf for a long time. I had written the music to it in probably 2011. I would always really liked that chord progression, and when we started going through material for the album, I remember bringing that music to you, and I remember you were like, I really have some lyrics that I think really fit the feel of the song, and
yeah, it's probably, I think, one of the only songs on the record where I wrote all the lyrics.
Yeah.
It's about this. The story is about a really like personal thing, experience that I went through. We don't need to go into detail about it, but I wanted it to almost be like you were having a conversation with someone, and you know, it's hard to say because the conversation obviously like turns for the worst at the end of the song, but that's life, and sometimes people make bad decisions. The point of the song, I guess, really is that, like, even when things are really dark, your friends are there for you, and, like, people, there are people that care about you, even if you feel like no one does. Yeah, it's a deep one.
Yeah, don't lose hope. It's almost like a conversation, too, that, like, I guess you wanted to have but never did. Like, yeah. You would have if you could have, and it's just too late.
It's crazy how much that song changed, though.
Yeah.
Because we rewrote the whole jam at the ending.
That's true. There was originally a different ending musically. It's funny, because I talk about having that song on the shelf. More or less, it was back then what it is now, and in between, it had that section at the end. There was, before we went to the studio, there was like a heavy section at the end of the song with some really syncopated, heavy breakdown.
Yeah.
And we decided as a whole that feel didn't really match the song and the gravity of the lyrics and what it was talking about. So
yeah.
We decided on the more solemn, dirge-like outro that it has currently. So.
So, track 8, Terminal. It's a pretty good song, I'd say. So when we were originally thinking about a song to come forward for Fearless Records, when we were going to announce our signing, we decided to write a song for that. And initially, Stars Before the Sun kind of represented our sound a bit more. So we decided to kind of leave this one and put it on as like a deeper track on the album, I guess you could say. I absolutely love this song, though. This is probably has one of my favorite lines in it. Our nature is to care, but we nurture our differences. I think that is an extremely amazing line. And I mean, you wrote most of the lyrics in this song too, so maybe you could explain a little more on
yeah,
what it's about.
This is the oddball track in the fact that I wrote all the lyrics for this one. This is one of the most, if not the most, socio-political songs on the record. It's just, I kind of wanted to vent and rant about some of the problems that I think, you know, we all have.
I think that line sums it up pretty well about,
yeah,
like, the state of our society in these
yeah,
days, too. So.
I agree. Yeah, it's, but yeah, this song is one of the most aggressive tracks on the record. It's one of the fastest, most metalcore-ish tracks. It's got the really heavy breakdown. It's got, you know, the blast beats and the really fast, like, shreddy riffs. It's one of the hardest songs to play on guitar on the record, just speed and kind of constant punishment going on. it's funny, though, honestly, because it ended up being one of my favorite tracks, but it was very hotly contested overall as we were writing it.
Oh man, we rewrote that chorus so many times, like three
yeah,
or four times, but like some of the songs will just come together and we're all happy with it, and others, you know, especially being digital, we can just sit here and keep going back and like, oh, I don't know about that, I don't know about that. So Yeah, I mean, we spent a lot of time on that.
Yeah, this was one of those songs where it didn't come so easily. We spent a lot of time going back and forth. Yeah, four different versions of the chorus melody until we finally came up with what we were happy with. But it ended up being a banger track after that, though, once we could all finally agree.
The name comes from Stanley Milgram, who is a famous psychologist, where he did the famous experiment of having people think that they're administering shocks to people that are testing, and they go up to lethal shock voltages.
Lethal levels.
Levels, and people will do it just because they're in what he coined as the agentic state.
They're being told to do it.
Right, and it shows you that people will...
Listen to authority.
Will listen to authority to... mind-blowing levels, really.
And if you have never read up on that, it's actually a really fascinating experiment.
Yeah.
I believe
Stanley
there's
Milgram.
Movies made about it, too. At least one that I can think of, but I can't remember
is
the
there?
Name.
I don't know.
Yeah. I think there's at least one. But that song, we kind of knew right away, was going to be about some deep shit, if you will. I went to Joe during the writing process of the record, and I was just like, I feel like Capstan hasn't done like a really fast song before, and just fast, short, to the point, and that's what this ended up being. As Scott and Joe said, 215 BPMs.
Yep, 215
is the fastest on the record, and it probably has the raunchiest lyrics. If the raunchy may not be the word, but Harry really went off.
He did
a little bit on that one.
He did, yeah. So, he went off. He had a goal and he hit it.
And he hit it right on, and. We like that song because it's definitely, it's not necessarily an outlier, but it gives the record an extra bit of girth.
Yeah, it's a jammer, like most tempo demanding, blast beats, craziness
if
the whole time.
If we ever play that, it'll be a day.
Yeah, if we ever play that, oh
like
man.
Like live, that'll be a day, so don't request it, please. Track 10, Stars Before the Sun. This is a big one. Personally, Stars Before the Sun is the biggest piece of this chapter of Capstan.
I call it the flagship song.
The flagship song. I think when we decided that it was going to be the song, we didn't really think it would garner the attention that it has.
Yeah.
We knew it would be good.
Pleasantly surprised.
We knew it would be good, and we loved the message. I remember writing at least like the initial verse of that in my room, and one bit about Capstan that's, I don't know if every band is like this, but we'll write a lot of lyrics and we'll kind of piece them together into songs. We'll take existing lyrics. With Stars, as soon as that song came in, I remember just having a big rush of like emotion, because Joe and Harry, while we would take it from Guitar Pro and we'd turn it into a demo, I remember the first time I heard it, like as the demo, I'm like, man, this song, this is it. This has got a really big feel to it. And those lyrics actually wrote to the song, which is weird to say we don't do that like a lot, or at least.
Yeah, not always.
Not always. And so I remember writing that and just how it fit. And I think we all love the message of the song as a whole. And it definitely portrays the part of Capstan that is like the genuine post-hardcore kind of, we're a lot of different things, but we always want to maintain bits and pieces of that for sure. So Stars really helped cement us, and as the first single technically off Restless Heart Keep Running, I don't think we knew at the time that it would be part of such a great collective work like this one.
Yeah, it really represents some of our favorite kind of technical things to do on the album as well. One of the most nerdy kind of technical things we do in a song is when we do a tempo change through tempos that are related to each other. And essentially what that means is that there may be two different tempos where there's some sort of note value you could play to where it would sound the same. And it basically tricks your ear into thinking that you're hearing kind of the same tempo at first, but then all of a sudden the pulse just changes and then you're in a new tempo. And it's a really cool kind of seamless way to go to tempos that are not very close to each other. And we do that in Stars Before the Sun.
And we do it with a key change.
Yeah, there's a key change at the end of that as well, going into the last chorus. And it goes from 3-4 to 4-4 as well, which is kind of how the thing works that makes it so interesting. Because it's essentially...
What is it exactly? Yeah, explain.
So what it is that three notes at 180, three eighth notes are equal to three eighth note triplets at 120. And so there you have it.
That's basically what we did.
Changing the pulse from every two notes to every three notes. And then when you do that, the guitar stays the same and the drums change. And that's how you get a cool kind of...
seamless feel.
Yeah, you don't notice the tempo change as much because at least one of the instruments is going to be doing the same note value. So, yeah, it's a cool little trick.
So while we also created a song that is very, to its core, what Capstan is, we also tricked people.
Yeah.
And we did what Capstan is at its core and doing cool stuff like that.
So. Yeah, it's well disguised, I think.
It's a
very easy to listen to song, you know, and it's got a chorus you can sing along to,
but it wasn't easy for Joe and Scott to write.
There's some hidden stuff in there that if you're really listening, it kind of mess with your brain.
Put it on top, the sprinkles on top. We're just talking about shit we care about.
Yeah.
I guess that's important too, is just that chorus, such sweet entropy. I don't know if there's three words that we've written that we like more, at least for what it entails about, like, I don't know, and it's kind of the theme of this record, live in the moment.
Yeah, it goes back to that same theme that we were talking about earlier.
Live as strongly as you can where you are, if that means putting your phone down, closing your computer, you know, go out, experience the world, experience your life, because you don't know what tomorrow it's going to bring. Everything is so, so fleeting.
That's true.
So...
Track 11, Hideaway. This originally was going to be just one acoustic guitar and my vocals, and we decided to change it to be more of a produced song. We added a string quartet to it, harmonies, basically just kind of give it some flow. It was intended to be the acoustic song on the record. Definitely changed quite a bit too with arrangement, but to get the vibe that we wanted for this song specifically, I had to lower my heart rate, and Andrew Wade actually sat me down right next to him at the control board, and I had no headphones, wasn't in the vocal booth, and I sang to the music that he had already recorded. No click, and it was probably one of the craziest vocal experiences I've had recording in the studio. But it really captured what the vibe was that we wanted for the song. I have never done falsetto before in my entire life, and that's something that we added to this element. So we're, you know, again, we have talked about it before. We try to do the highest highs, the lowest lows, and, you know, heavy, non-heavy. And this was definitely the softest song that I think I've ever recorded. And I'm actually very happy with the way it turned out. You know, Mike Tompa killed it on the strings, the harmonies too. It's kind of funny. We got to a certain point in the song where we were like, okay, that's enough harmony. We don't need any more. And Joe actually left, and he was the one that was just like, yo, no more harmonies. And Harry and I stayed a little bit extra, stayed a little bit later, and we ended up recording some of my favorite harmonies on the song. So
and they stayed there. And the ones that
Harry and I recorded, actually, yeah, they did stay.
Suck it, Joe.
So, so yeah. So track 12.
12.
Nothing Met, Nothing Moved. I like this song. It's a good song.
It's deeper on the record. It's crazy to think that this is what became out as track 12. Not that we tried to bury it on the record, but like, there's a lot of songs.
Yeah.
On this record.
13 is a lot of songs. So.
This one, I remember we went back and forth a lot on the singles, on what our singles initially were going to be. And while we didn't have any lyrics in place, this was a contender at one point. Upbeat, multiple choruses. It definitely was something we considered. I think as we progressed in working on the record, we had a little trouble putting the lyrics to this song.
Yes.
We went back and forth a few times. Didn't Scott say there was an extended version of this song at one point, and we kind of had to trim the fat.
We pulled it, yep.
A little bit. But I'll never forget the breakthrough of kind of why it made the record. I wrote most of the lyrics to the song and Harry the bridge, but I don't think we had anything in place when we were on tour with Silverstein. And I remember it was in Sacramento. I just had a little bit of time, and I don't know if I was just thinking outside the box that day or really just trying to bring some of the lyrics that I had written that hadn't been used. And this song really fit kind of what the thought process I was on that day. And it really turned into a lot more than I thought. I don't want to say we're religious or not, but this song is of personal struggle, and identifying with spirituality or religion or whatever you want to call it, just trying to find the truth, your truth in your everyday, your truth in what's in your heart. And I think I'm really happy with the way this song came out and at least what it means to me and hopefully what other people take away from it, where like it's okay not to know what's out there. There's okay to ask questions.
It's good to keep an open mind with these types of things, yeah, too, in my opinion.
So. Anywhere you go, any types of people that you encounter, like always have an open mind. And this isn't from the perspective I wrote this, isn't necessarily about like, oh, this is the truth. It's just more of an inward...
inward look in what you believe.
Or what I don't
believe. What you don't believe.
Or what I'm trying to believe. Exactly. So Nothing Meant, Nothing Moved. It came out pretty good and really, really enjoyed how it contributed to the overall message of the record as a whole.
Absolutely.
So track number 13, The Love That Remains.
Last track on the record, yeah.
Last one.
The final countdown. This track, I think, collectively is probably our favorite track as a band, like all the members individually. We really love it. It is probably the most changed song on the record. We were originally kind of like, I know Scott mentioned this with Indelible, the basic kind of structure of The Love That Remains was originally supposed to be on In the Wake of our Discord as well, and we ended up saving it for later, changing it immensely, and then changing it some more and some more and some more. I think this song is the song we've changed the most out of any song ever, and it was worth all the headache.
I like to think so.
I think we got the best possible version that we could have out of it, and
this is another one of those songs that like we didn't finish it like lyrically until we were already in the studio because there's like it basically what's the word encapsulates?
Well, there are all kinds of words. It encapsulates. You got it.
So this what's so special is that it encapsulates the entire record. And
it's kind of
lyrically.
Like a summary of all the themes.
Yeah, there's
that
a
we
callback.
So
I think to, I think it's every
there's
song.
There's a callback to every song. Yeah,
lyrically.
Yeah. So. Yeah, because in the second verse part, it references Fix, Abstracted, Indelible,
Right Away.
Yeah, it references pretty much all the other songs in its lyrics.
But I think this was also the last song lyrically that we finished.
Yes,
but we had to do it that way though because we had to finish up the rest of the songs so that we would know what we wanted to say in the last song.
Yeah.
I feel like the only way we could have done it, but...
so many things came together last minute for the song in the studio. We never originally intended for it to have saxophone on it. Originally, actually, the first verse didn't even have any sort of break instrumentally. The lyrics kind of just flowed through, and then Harry was like, I have an idea here. We can kind of just insert some space here, let it breathe a little bit. And you had
ripped it on the guitar at first.
Yeah, Andrew Wade and I kind of wrote a little thing together, kind of like this guitar lead. And then I think it was you who had the idea. It was like, what if we have some other sort of interesting instrument play this part? And then so We had our friend Billy Meether again rip his alto sax on this part.
Yeah, and then even at the end of that, we're like, are we done with the saxophone? And we're everyone's like, we could probably
let's go back to the end, because it sort of kind of just jams out, and then we're like, let's kind of, you know, restate the whole ending message of the song and, like, you know, redo the vocal melody on the saxophone and kind of, like, close it out that way. And I was really happy with the way that turned out, too. I think it's kind of a cool, interesting mixture of, because you have, like, the three guitars and it's really kind of, like, ambient-ish, but then there's, like, the 16th note double bass going on, and then this cool, like, sax solo on top of it. It kind of makes for an interesting...
I definitely think it's my personal favorite on the record.
Yeah, it really turned into something special, I think.